Foreign Minister Khiang Wakang, welcome to the program.
Well, thank you for having me back on your program, Christian.
You know, when we last spoke, it was a very, very different world. And now, today, December 2020, you in South Korea are facing a third wave, maybe even a fourth wave of this coronavirus. Just tell me why this latest one is so difficult to control.
Yes, we are in the midst of our third wave, which is turning out to be higher than the first and lasting much longer. And it is thus because the virus has now penetrated into every corner of everyday life of people, and this happening mostly in the metropolitan Seoul area. And you know how packed with people this particular area is in a country that is already one of the most population density-wise, high-density country. So it's you know, today, in fact, we've hit the highest number so far at 1,073 new confirmed cases, including, of course, those who have recently come in from overseas. But, you know, our system is now ramping up on all three T's, the testing, the tracing, and the treatment. And so it's time for, you know, us to be ramping up on the basic setup, which is our very robust three T's. Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you, though, just to back up a little bit, because treatment involves, obviously, hospitalizations. Mm-hmm. And we understand that literally at this moment, you may have only one ICU bed available, one bed available in, as you say, your very densely populated capital. That's a real problem.
Yes, I think that securing more hospital beds is the challenge of the day. Yesterday, today, and the days going forward, we're also a system where just 10% of our beds are publicly administered. The 90%, the rest, are in private hospitals. So our health authorities are also talking to the private hospitals to secure some beds in the private settings. So I think there are a series of flexibility going forward, but of course we want to make sure that our public facilities are fully utilized before we travel down that road. Mm-hmm.
Can I ask you to react to what the Prime Minister said just yesterday? You know, basically, you know, lamenting the fact, as he says, that South Koreans have let their guard down after such pretty, you know, impressive discipline and control in the first wave. He said yesterday, while most follow the rules, some are fueling the ferocious spread of the virus with their carelessness and irresponsibility. Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering whether this will lead, I don't know whether you can tell me about what your government is discussing, you know, for the first time, a lockdown, a soft lockdown, a hard lockdown, but some kind of lockdown.
This is a very difficult discussion. Some say, yes, we should. Some say, no, we shouldn't hurry into it, because the social economic consequences are going to be so huge. So you have to work through how this will play out, if that it will be effective in terms of capturing the further spread of the virus. So it's a very, very tough discussion and a tough call if it should be made. But if we make that call, we want to be as prepared as possible in terms of the measures that need to be in place to help out with the small restaurant owners, small businesses, and so on and so forth. Yes, so we are in discussion, but the decision has not been made yet. And I have to say, I think there was a little bit of complacency setting in after the successes and, of course, our experience and the way we've handled this being touted as a success by the foreign media. I think perhaps that has led to a certain amount of complacency.
Well, you know, I mean, it has also still to be pointed out that comparatively, South Korea has a pretty, what your own government has called, manageable caseload.
Yes. We're 612, the death count, and slightly over 45,000 case counts as of today. Compared to other OECD countries, I think we're the second lowest next to New Zealand in terms of the confirmed cases and the death numbers. Mm-hmm. Of course, we're also a country with a much larger population and much higher population density than New Zealand. But compared to others, we are very low, but it's all comparative. We're used to low numbers. And once those low numbers start ticking up again, of course, it makes us all on high alert.
Let me ask you about vaccines in general and vaccine hesitancy. You've already, according to your public health officials, had a pretty bad rap when it comes to taking the flu vaccine. You've tried, let me get the figures right, you've tried to vaccinate 30 million people against the flu, which was 10 million more than last year. But, you know, there were huge rumors that spread online, which created a lack of confidence. A few people died, but then immediately your health officials said that it was not related to the vaccine at all. But there's a lot of social media conspiracy theories, which is creating a pretty unusual vaccine hesitancy in your country.
I think the story with the influenza vaccines, I think that's pretty much put to rest. I think the flu vaccine story is not a concern. I think we have surveyed the people's willingness to take the COVAX-19 vaccines if the vaccine was proved safe and effective. And I think the survey came out to be something like 70%. So I wouldn't worry too much about vaccine hesitancy in Korea.
All right, well, that's good. Can I ask you to comment on how you think your neighbor to the north is handling it? Do you, with your intelligence capacities, think that North Korea has a big outbreak, a small outbreak, handling it well, handling it badly? What's going on?
Well, their official story is that they have no case, confirmed case. I think given that this is a virus that spreads very quickly, and even in countries that quickly close down, the virus got in and spread. So it's hard to believe that there aren't any cases, but that's the official story. We have offered to work together on the containment of this together, but they have not replied to our offer of working together and assisting to fight this pandemic.
All right. So let me talk to you more then about sort of your remit now as foreign minister. And remember, you were, of course, the first South Korean foreign minister to visit North Korea. But I want to ask you in terms of U.S. relations. Mm-hmm. Should I just bluntly ask you, are you relieved that there will be a new administration, given what were some difficulties between South Korea and the Trump administration?
With the Trump administration, given his very unconventional style, I think that did pose a challenge to those of us who are more used to and comfortable with the more conventional style of doing diplomacy. But having said that, I worked very closely with my own counterpart, Mike Pompeo. We disagreed on many things. We had arguments, but I think the nature of the relationship is such that we can really have a genuine discussion on issues that we don't agree on and move on. And I think we will have that same level of honest, close discussion with the incoming administration. Given the signals coming from the incoming team during the campaign, after the campaign, their remarks about the importance of the alliance, the importance of South Korea in their global scheme of things, I expect to have a very close and very good working relationship with my counterpart and our team and their team.
What is happening with your leaflet law? It was a known program of kind of getting South Korean information into North Korea. The parliament this week has criminalized that leaflet law.
Well, this wasn't the first time that parliament tried to proscribe that activity. There have been a dozen legislative initiative over the years since 2008, I believe, because this is happening in a very sensitive area, the most militarized zone in the whole world, with people living right next to the border area. And we have an incident in 2014 when the balloon was shot at by anti-aircraft artillery by the North Koreans, and the South Koreans military felt compelled to shoot back. So in an area where highly a militarily tense area where anything can go wrong, lead to even bigger clashes. And the people living near the border have been asking that these activities stop for years. And so I think this time the parliament has there was a recent incident of balloons going towards the north, and the North Korean replied by completely blowing up the Kaesong liaison office. You know, this argument that this is a restriction on freedom of expression. Freedom of expression, I think, is absolutely a vital human right, but it's not absolute. It can be limited according to the ICCPR. It has to be by law. It has to be limited in scope. And it is limited in scope. It is only when these acts poses harm or poses danger to the life and the security of our peoples.
Gosh, I have to say, listening to you, it really is kind of way out of proportion. I mean, to react to balloons with anti-aircraft artillery and all the rest of it. But still, it is the DMZ, and it is a pretty unusual place. Let me finally end this by asking you about yourself. Kyung Hwa Kwon, you are the first South Korean female foreign minister. You've said last month that you felt prejudice towards women while working in, quote, male-centered culture of vested interest. Tell me about that, and what needs to be done further in your country?
Well, I think lots have changed. Just the fact of me in this position and in this position for so long is certainly me trying hard, but also the support I get from staff at senior levels and junior levels. It is also the junior staff who are majority female coming into the ministry who are rooting me, and so I think I owe them this responsibility of doing my very best in this position. I think all women in leadership positions feel that to a certain extent. It is also political will needed on the part of our male colleagues. I'm here because my president decided that he wanted to put a woman in a position of very important leadership as part of his cabinet membership. I think we also have to make sure that women with careers can pursue that career and family life together with their male spouses. Still, the housework, child caring, this is predominantly on the side of women. And so we have to introduce more support for young families, parents struggling careers and childcare altogether. Clearly seeing the self-interest, self-benefit in the long run of sharing that equitably with women.
Indeed. Foreign Minister Kyung Hwa Kwon, thank you so much indeed for joining us.
Thank you, Christian.